Times as long as you are mine. Welcome to another production of Edification. I am your host, Ak Abarala Bar YASHAR’AL. In this episode of Production Edification, we are going to investigate the resurrection, or should I say the resurgence, of Canaan's Elohim, specifically their chief power called El, along with his son Baal, aka the Lord, and how foreign languages have been used as well as are trying to be used to beguile and trick many of our people into giving praise, worship, and honor to them. They are, for the most part, identity thieves and have stolen the praise of our Yahweh. We were told early in our records by Rashiach how this serpent beast was more subtle than any of the beasts of the field. We just didn't know that settlement, trickery, secretive, or deceptive magic. Many of us have fallen for the okey-doke, but I, for one, am in the process of repenting and changing directions as I have discovered my own error. I am repackaging myself, image, and name to reflect my truer nature as an Aubrey with Aubrey heritage, which mirrors our father Abram, Abram Ha'Abari, through Yitzhak and Yaakov, whom are hated in this earth. We were warned not to receive these languages and speech because they contain the names of these many other mighty ones. We may have taken this information lightly previously, but I am stressing, do not take Yahweh for a joke, nor his commandments, or Torah. If you are unable to repent, then we can at the very least confess our sins and receive forgiveness through the sacrificial blood offering made by Yahweh himself, which was given for us to atone for our sins. It's called pleading the blood. Through language, the names of mighty ones of Canaanites have been continually heard out of our mouths, which transgress Yahweh's Torah. All praises and thanks be to Yahweh, who has shown mercy to us and given grace to those of us that believe on him and even upon his name Yahweh Shai, that he is Yahweh in human flesh. There is a push from within our own ranks to reintroduce these mighty ones into our communities by the use of exotic enemy languages, and by continually brushing off as nothing our casual use of these enemy names with the Christian mindset, oh, the Lord knows my heart. These differences in languages between the original Aborith and the Phoenician Canaanite language are so minuscule, yet the consequences of the slightness in technicalities and misusage brings out severe punishment from our Most High Power, Yahweh, because it is written that even his name is a jealous name. Exodus 34 and 14. Thank you. Our Aramaic Abari tongue was passed on to us through Nok, Sham, Aram, and Abar. We have dialectic differences, as when using the changeable sounds of the Wa, which changes Yahweh to Yahuwah for some groups and to Yahuwah for others. These are dialectic choices and social preferences, as well as tribal lists. There is no right or wrong right now until Yahweh makes his name perfectly clear to everyone. All right, so let's get a few things clear. Yahweh Shai grew up in a roughneck hood, a sanctuary city, a city like a Chicago, like a LA, or like a Bronx, New York, where people were living in the darkness and you could get your throat cut for looking at a cat the wrong way. The historians agree, Yahweh Shai and his Lamadim spoke that old school, hardcore language of Aramaic Abari with a Galilean slang that was very different from that of that Yiddish being spoken in Yerushalayim. Yerushalayim was a melting pot of people and languages in Yahweh Shai's day. But just saying, even though it was against the law to speak certain names outside of the temple, these brothers probably broke that Jewish law often. Right, okay. So in my studies and research, I keep coming across this word Hebrew, that it's a Greek word. I am not the product of a Greek. I am an Abari, a child of the Father and a brother of the Son. And so are all of you children of YASHAR’AL, who are awakened to your true nationality. That word Hebrew has no connection to or meaning of nothing in the Abari language, nor Greek tongue for that matter. It's just a word that supposedly represents a people. Go figure that one. Abari is a word with hidden meaning, which I will reveal today. Ab means father, bar means son or son of. The Y at the end means me, my, or mine. My father and the son of my father, we are akkad in one word. Abari refers to a person of the father and of the son. It is also a reference to one who has crossed over from the waters above to the waters below and back to the waters above, or have crossed over from the other region. Yohanna 10 and 30, I and my Father are one. Might as well put there Abari, Akkad. We crossed over. The language of the Abari people is reflective of the Mighty One, who is the Father and Son as one person. Allahu Akbar in Arabic transliterates to our Abari tongue as our power and our brother, the son of power. Our language speaks to us.
The Aramaic Abari is a language of sound and pictures. We transmit images and symbols with sound and vice versa. Follow me as I pronounce the sounds spiritually revealed to me of the symbols below each sound as seen on your screen, from right to left, top down. Ah, ba, ga, da, ha, ua, za, ka, ta, ia, ka, la, ma, na, sa, ai, pa, taza, kwa, ra, sha, ta. Did you hear the vowel sounds? The A, E, I, O, N, U? With the wa sound accounting for both the U and the O? Here is a good tool for learning and for making comparisons between time periods and fonts of those times. So if someone was wearing or writing in ancient fonts, but you have studied modern square script, you can translate or read both using this chart, hopefully. Even though it's based on Jewish Masoretic Hebrew, Yiddish, it is easily converted to Arabic by mentally exchanging all the I's and E's under the name column to Aleph or A's. Then change all of the O's and U's to the W or the W. However, extremely important and most importantly is to replace that E-L, L, in that first row under the name with Al, A-L, for Aleph or Allah. And you have yourself a fairly accurate and useful alphabet chart. The only way you can ever get L out of Aleph is to convert Canaanite Phoenician to Jewish Masoretic Hebrew. One final observance to make about this chart. Four items. Look at the sound column. First word or letter or Aleph points to the yod and the sound it makes. The yod makes the Y sound as in you and as in a long E sound, E. That's why you hear me say iyad, iyad. The second letter points to the Aleph bat, the wa, and makes the sound W as in what? U and O sound. Third letter points to the ayin, makes the sound I as well as A. And the fourth and last is the ga. They don't use it anymore. It was merged with the ayin, but I still use it. And it makes the sound ga or na. But I don't even, there's only one I say ga. All right? All right, so let's briefly discuss why I emphasize learning the true Aramaic Abari over the Yiddish and the English translations. On the screen to the left, you see the English translation of Exodus. Well, when I see or read that word Exodus, I immediately get the image of some Caucasians from the movie Moses crossing the Red Sea. That's called programming. TV and movie sorcery, I say. They say TV and movie magic. Versus what you should be grasping, as you see on the screen to the right, with the word shama'uat, or shamut. U'ala shamut. And these are the names of them which were called out of. Well, when I see names like Isaac, Jacob, I think of British Caucasians and Khazar Jews. But when I hear Yatashak and Yaakov, I think that the image of brothers come to mind, my people. So it's hard to break programming when you don't even address the methods and the modes of programming, which one of them is language. And you have to break the language barrier to be most effective in deprogramming yourself. I intend to prove the Most High calls himself Allah in Aramaic Abari.
Alrighty, here's my source. TheBibleHub.com, interlinear version of Exodus 6 and 3, or should I say Shemot. Let me blow this up a little. Now, there's some information we need to understand first. Highlighted with yellow are Strong's Concordance numbers to look up. Word meanings, like the E in brackets represents actually the H for Hebrew. So each one of those numbers in the yellow are Hebrew numbers. If it was Greek, it would be in the G. It would be G or A for Aramaic. Highlighted with the blue is the Yiddish pronunciation word Q. Highlighted in red is the Aramaic square script with jots and tittles. I don't read them, so there'll be no explanation because I don't understand them. I won't read them. In the green is the English translation. All right. Lastly, and most important, in the purplish or blue, purplish blue, is identifiers for like names, N for name or noun, or a prep for preposition, a conjecture or conjective or something like that, V for verb. You need to know this information to prevent confusing a preposition with a noun or a proper pronoun, which are treated differently. Names generally are read letter for letter, and prepositions are treated just a little different. You pronounce the whole word. So names often retain the last A sound as well. And you're going to see this again later on in this program. Example 413 is pronounced Al, while H410 is pronounced Allah. We're going to get to this a little bit. Be a little patient with me. We're almost through this. We read the sounds on the earlier chart. Now we'll apply them here. Just the last two word groupings is all we're going to deal with. After Yahweh said, and I appeared to Abraham and to Yitzhak and to Yaakov, he started and said, Ba, Ah, La, Sha, Da, Yah. There, and there it is. Just that simple. Clear as day. Now, if you think Yahweh was speaking Yiddish, then you read from the blue line where he is saying he is the L. And I think you know who L is by now. And if you think he was speaking English, well, you'd read from the green line where he would call himself a Babylonian deity called G-O-D. But if you believe and know he was speaking in Ivory, then you read in the red. The Aramaic square script without the vowel points, period. And that's what he's saying. Ba Allah Shaddaiya. This is getting to a point like beating a dead horse. But this horse is stubborn and stiff-necked. So, only a few days ago, I would have read Genesis 17:1, that's Bereshith, still thinking the Most High was commanding Abram to stand up from a bowed position and walk before him being perfect, like presently at that time. However, the Most High is teaching me new insights daily. He revealed to me he was not commanding Abram, but instead complimenting him for the walk Abram had already performed up to that very time. Rather than dispatch a messenger angel, the Most High appeared in person to express his approval in a complimentary way and reward Abram with the highest honor
an accreditation bestowed upon him by the Most High himself. Well, what did Abram do? He left his father's house for lands unknown. In obedience to spiritual insights, he offered Yatashak for a burnt offering, obeying spiritual insights. He believed his seed would be as numerous as the stars of the heavens above. He believed Yahweh, his power, and his personal friend. And that belief in action was credited to him as righteousness. Then I was given two witnesses to back up this account. Bereshith 15 and 6 and Galatians 3 and 6. Plus, the renewed understanding of our language, Ha'atah, the you, becoming that of yours, referring to halak, which means to walk. And he's talking about that walk of yours is blameless before me. That's what he was saying to Abraham. It's complimenting, not commanding. Then remembering the Jewish people based their law in what's called halakha, which is a way of walking. I have become settled that this spiritual insight is true, validated as well as attested to by two witnesses required by our law. My people perish for a lack of knowledge. You have been deeply programmed with negativity to the point that you hate your own Ivory tongue, so much so that you choose the language of your enemies, which are heavy laden with praise to their mighty ones, in opposition to your own power. You have been so programmed to hate a culture that came from your own forefathers. Even the general told you that Muhammad learned from Ivorian people, avoiding any and everything Arab. Well, who called it Arab in the first place? Are those Edomite babies, Greek babies, and Roman babies in the so-called Arab world the true YASHAR’AL Hayim? No, hell no. Think for yourselves. Stop paying wicked people to program you. My whole purpose for making this video is because I saw an Ak trying to drag Ak Farrakhan for teaching YASHAR’ALahim to call upon Allah rather than call upon the God of Israel. And another Ak teaching that Masoretic Hebrew Yiddish should be our common language with all of its references to El and Elohim. I cringe with shame at both. Check it out, Ak. When you remove the Yah from YASHAR’ALah and make it a Yi, and then you take away the Lamet, the shepherd's staff, from the Allah and give it to the El in YISRAEL, well, you sort of kind of curse yourself and all who follow after you. You have made yourself and your followers an out of an Asherah of El, who is both the wife of El and the consort of Baal. This all sort of reminds me of a story of Semiramis, Nimrod, and Tammuz. Remember them? This is what you have done, Ak, Jediah, Melech of Kai Yeshua, by teaching Ivorian followers to speak Jewish Masoretic vowel pointing systems for Yiddish instead of teaching them the language of the true Ivory. I have seen you go off on the general, calling him fat and out of shape and talking about how he couldn't climb stairs for not agreeing with you, I imagine. Yet, in the video, you sweating bullets and appear to be just as big as Akihana to me. Y'all about the same size. I've never seen the general purposefully manipulate the words of the Most High as I've seen you do twice. Maybe it's time to call a witch a witch. I would normally just ask you to repent, but I doubt you will. You have a mean, ugly spirit upon you. I watched you attack a good family who became ashamed to call themselves Hebrew Israelites. any longer because of the excellent job of the field agents infiltrating the community and labeling us as black extremists, black identity extremist groups. The Watchman and Deborah and her son is who I'm talking about, whom you seem to hate. I don't understand it. I watched you verbally attack a Christian woman outside of her own place of worship. It's one thing to attempt to persuade or reason with someone out of the scriptures. It's another thing to attack. It's not our calling to go out and attack. But again, that's that ugly spirit of El and Elohim in which you worship. How much are you getting paid? Or is it a better question to ask, how much are you paying to do your own family harm, worshiping the wrong power, worshiping an idol? Yahweh was right. Israel is a contrary harlot who pays her lovers instead of getting paid. By the way, y'all over there at Kai Yeshua, y'all still calling that month of the calendar year Tammuz after that Sumerian deity while lying and saying you're keeping the law? You do know you are breaking Torah by speaking that name, right? It is written that rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. Are you a witch? What is a male witch called? And what does our law say we must do with witches? Anyone? Did you attempt to cast a word spell using Strong's Bible Concordance number H413, a preposition, and adding it to a noun, and accusing me and my Abarim brothers of performing that ritual as a curse? Is that what you did? I myself rebuke you by Yahweh, by Hashem, Yahweh Shai. But I also hope you would repent and change your course before it's too late. Didn't you make claim that Abarim are cursing the nation by calling our nation YASHAR’AL? No, sir. You are the curse speaking that accursed language in the Jewish Masoretic vowel point system with jots and tittles all over the place. You are the cause of the curse, if there is a curse, upon yourself. You know, didn't you hear, you cannot curse this nation. All curses sent out, just return to the person who sent it out. You cannot curse us. And we don't send out any curses. I don't wish you any harm. I wish you would repent. That's the only, I hope you'd repent. Where is the rule book that you are following? I want to read the rules for myself. I'll be happy to repent of any error I'm caught up in. I'm happy to repent upon learning the truth. Because as far as I know, the same rule that allows you to shorten YISRAEL to YISRAEL is the same rule that I'm following in order to shorten YASHAR’AL to YASHAR’AL, hyphenated or not. Where's the rule book on this subject matter? And please don't point me to no James Strong's exhaustive concordance. The Allah of YASHAR’AL is not dealing with that person. James Strong and his book are just tools for me to use, and is not a law or a hard and fast rule that I must follow, but are only stepping stones. The information being received by me is from on high above. Trumps all the books and persons. Anything else? Not to boast, but I have to establish some validity about myself. I have received the gift of speaking in tongues. Even though I stutter and get tongue-tied, and with my primary back-asswards satanic tongue English, I still have the gift of speaking in tongues, and in part, the interpretation of tongues. Let me ask you, Bakar nor dut ting bit kong? Kanst du Deutsch sprechen? Na mila selinika? Parlez-vous français? Ati govorich porutski? Anata wan nehango hanasemaska? latine loquitibi. Se hablo español, ata medabar abari. You understand? You can't touch me when it comes to these languages. I have unsubscribed from your channel, being that a witch can't teach me anything. Not a damn thing at all. That 364-day Enochian calendar is useless in this day and age unless you know when exactly the spring equinox occurs each and every year. If you don't know when, that calendar is doing you no good. You delivered a God the bar, and now I can no longer trust you on anything you have ever said. All you have ever done was lie. Now, to my fellow Abari over at the House of David, whose channel is HODC, The Uprising, YASHAR’AL, where to start? Brother, you have these huge olive dots written across your chest, yet you do not know how to read the meaning of the olive dot? What are they teaching you over there at the House of David? Ak, you didn't know that Allah is the power in YASHAR’AL? Ak, Louis Farrakhan didn't lie to you, bruh, about Allah being the same power in that we Abarim worship. He wasn't telling you a lie. He is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. You and Farrakhan both are still using that pagan title G-O-D. And you actually is the G-O-D of Israel? El is the power of Canaanites. Please repent from referring to that name ever again, period. Try to work it out of your vocabulary. That name is not to be heard out of your mouth if you're going to call yourself a law keeper and attest to that Old Testament. I suggest you get up under the blood covenant of that new covenant and be covered by the blood so you can plead the blood of your Hamashiach. Thank Yahweh for his mercy and grace he has shed upon us in this day. If we can't repent because of this English and all this other trash language that we speak that is not our native tongue, then we had better learn to plead the blood. Check, or should I say chiak, yourself, Ak. Yahweh Shai would say to you in Matthew 7:5, you hypocrite, first take the beam out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Leave Ak Farrakhan alone, bruh. Them brothers over there at NOI, Nation of Islam, are Abari YASHAR’ALAIM. Yahweh has already put Farrakhan in check. He didn't need you to do that, cuz. He already forced this man to reveal to those people who they are. You understand? That's why he had to reveal to them Akyam and Akwatyam who they really are. The rest will fall into place, huh? When them brothers and sisters start to reading our records with new eyes, that they are the people, they're going to read those passages that says, do this throughout your generations. They're going to see the same thing you've been shown. You know, they already adhere to strict dietary laws and maintain high standards of discipline within their ranks. Our women under their leadership are already very accustomed to dressing in modest apparel and shamefacedness. Now, how far from the truth do you think they really are? You know, get them to stop visiting that cobblestone and participating in that Saturn walk around that Saturn cube. Remove the prayer beads and repetitive speech and prayer. And you know, you're not that far away from being walking in perfection. Are places you have... Those are some of the places you could have checked them on. Those are some of the things you could have checked them on. When they start reading the law, they'll start to grow their beards again and obey the laws as well. Let me ask you this, Ak. When Daniel opened the window real wide and prayed, do you think the people heard him in his speaking, or did they see him performing Salat prayers 3 times a day? Allah is not the name of the power, but it is the way we Abarim identify our mighty one, our power, in our Abari language and in our Abari tongue. Repent yourself, Learn who you are and fix you before you try to fix a recognized leader. Remember, no leadership is in place without Yahweh Elohim allowing it to be. Abraham had many children. Guess what all Abraham's children learned from him when he was alive? They learned from him how to call on the power Almighty and call him by what Abraham only knew. Abraham called him Allah. That's all he knew. It tells you that in the scripture. Our Abarim people are language innovators and creators. When I was growing up, people had created a language called Pig Latin. Have we so soon forgotten about Michael Jackson, who remade bad, a negative term to mean something good, strong, and positive? That's what we do out. We're language innovators. We language creators. Now, let me just Shalom Aleichem and Yahweh Barakatah, all right?
Hell out of here.
Indeed. Another did come in his own Roman name, Jesus, as JC. Not only did he come in his own name, but he also came in his very own image as well. More importantly, he came in the image of his own people and pulled off the greatest identity theft in the history of the world, stealing the identity of the true Abari, son of the Most High Power. And you wonder how Eve was beguiled in the garden? Huh? The devil is a master of deception, persuasion, enchantment, seduction, charm, and bewitchment, etc. How about we do this? How about we stop teaching the people disgusting, freaking, detestable lies such as JC was a so-called black man? He was not. Cease and desist with the freaking lies, damn agents. JC is and was a so-called Caucasian cat whose real name is Cesare Borgia, the son of a Pope Alexander VI, the vicar of a deity called G-O-D here on earth. JC is a fake and counterfeit and stole the identity of a true Abari named Yehoshua or Yeshua in the Yiddish tongue. We should all be aware by now that languages are sound-based and that pictures or images are conveyed via sound. Transliteration is the attempt to mimic or replicate the same sound of a word or a name in one language using the fonts and alphabets of another language to make the same sound of that word or name in that tongue or language. Yahawashah's parents were told exactly what to name him, and they did so officially name him that in the temple of Yerushalayim. However, he also had to be registered with the established Jewish government overseen by an Edomite king, loyal to the Roman Empire, and was issued a Jewish government Yiddish name of Yehoshua, which degrades to Yeshua and transliterates to Joshua in the English tongue. Nobody talks about this Joshua because everyone seems to be stuck on stupid talking about this Caucasian cat, Jesus, who came in his own freaking Roman Italian name and his own damned image as JC. The hell out of here. Yahweh, Yahoo, Yah, nor any of the derivatives of those names were permitted to be spoken outside of the temple of our synagogues back in those days by law of those Jewish rabbis backed by Edomite rulers of that day. They built up religious laws based on their own traditions that superseded Torah. You could literally be crucified for speaking those names in that day. Nobody was running around talking about Yahweh Shai, Yahweh, Yahoo, none of that. JC is the Lord God Baal and is the chief devil representative of that nation troop. Period. The definition of Baal in Hebrew literally means owner, master, Lord. It also means he took possession of. Remember this one. He took possession of. And also it means he married. So the question was unveiled. If Baal means Lord, then we should not use the word Lord? The answer to whoever asked that question, that's true. We should not use that word Lord. But many are seduced and charmed into doing so anyway.
God. God. God.
The Gemel and the Dalet we have been programmed to pronounce as Gad. But actually, it is pronounced God, as seen in 1409. There seems to be a rule, unwritten, that suggests keeping the last R sound within names and proper pronouns is technically okay. So, God, Agada, is also technically correct, which will play a special part in understanding the story we're about to be unveiled. About a people called the Gadarenes and their country. God is also the name of a Babylonian deity called Truth, but you have heard of him in the movies being referred to as Legion. It is also the name meaning a name meaning fortune, and you will see how that plays out as well. God is also the name of a tribe of YISRAEL. Allah is the power of YISRAEL, meaning that he shall rule as Allah, or he is the prince of Allah. Allah means power, strength, and mighty one, and can be shortened to A-L-O-W. Period. In Barash Yat, so-called Genesis 30 and 11, Princess Leah, La'ai in the Abari, was expecting a good dowry from the Most High, but she didn't understand it until Barash Yat 30 and 20, when she finally understood that her wealth and fortune given by the Most High was Zabalawan, or housed within her own body as fruitful ovaries. I don't think she knew she was also prophesizing a future event regarding her handmaid Zilpah's son, and the tragedy that would befall God in his own so-called God's country. Baal Gad literally translates to English as Lord God and means a troop of masters. Now, who held our ancestors in slavery and forced them to call them master? Who did that? I came across this Aquax channel some 4+ years back and discovered she has some excellent insights regarding various languages. Her research reveals some extremely interesting visions openers, eye openers. But this one really opened my eyes when it comes to the who's who in our records. The codes and the encryptions are out of this world. In general, the suffix reigns pertains to persons, places, or things of the same heritage, class, place, or group. Gadarenes, Gadarenes, We're going to find out who they are. Sharp.
So how did these Khazars come to call themselves Jews? The Maccabees hired a number of these mercenaries to help them overthrow the Greeks and recapture the temple at Yerushalayim. The Maccabees taught these people the customs and traditions of the Abarim. But later these guys created a religion called Judaism and began to convert en masse. These guys are known for not losing wars. They are also known phallic worshippers.
The parable of the good man possessed with unclean spirit goes as follows. There is a good man and his family who once dwelled in Canaan land, back in the east, that never kept his own laws, statutes, and commandments. He got sick of the violent hordes of men that surrounded him on every side, who made war with him often, killing and enslaving his people. Even his own brethren from the southlands would attack him. So the Most High offered this man and his family the opportunity to lead the multitude of warlike heathens and go to a new country where never dwelt any man before. And they took this counsel among themselves and agreed to lead the multitudes of the violent neighbors for new shores of a homeland called Arazarath or Arizonath. The Most High stayed the floods of the violent waters in the oceans and showed them the way across the sea. And once there in their own land, they began to keep their laws, statutes, and commandments and lived in relative peace. Of course, every family have their petty squabbles and feuds occasionally, but they maintained relative peace. After many, many new moons of relative peace in their own country, some strange ships appeared on the horizon, and there came ashore bearing some wicked foreigners claiming to be on pilgrimage to find their fortune in G-O-D, gold, oil, and drugs, as well as a treasure city of gold called El Dorado. These wicked strangers were so hell-bent on finding their fortune, G-O-D, and treasure that they forsook to plant food and prepare for the winter. The good man and his family members watched from afar off as these evil wicked men begin to starve and to feed off the flesh of their own dead comrades. But then they decided they would help. They bought in fresh foods of fruits and vegetables and clean meats to eat. But the thanks they received was a massacre of this good man's family. They beat the man, raped his wife, raped his daughters, and killed off many of his sons. They called in reinforcements who further invaded God's country and took possession of Arizonath, calling their invasion a manifest destiny. The evil one forced the remnant of this good man into hellhole death traps and called them internment camps. Later called them reservations, but they were cities of tombs for interring the dead. The wicked stranger that came from across the sea took possession of the man's lands, house, food, and his family, and eventually he possessed the man as well, while in control of all the wealth of God's country.
I'm about to starve to death.
This evil wicked man never offered to share any of the wealth or prosperity with the good man, all while calling the God man a savage and a beast. So the story picks up again in the book of Mark, where the son of the landlord has been dispatched as emissary to find out why the rents of 10% in tithes and offerings have ceased. The good man of the house of Arazanath
after all, does not own the land, but was renting and sharecropping with the Most High all alone. The records state that while this son, along with 12 select of his followers, were crossing the sea, the winds in the sea turned violent and seemingly would capsize and destroy the boat, killing all on board. So with good cause, the son was awakened from his deep sleep by his students, who feared for their lives in panic. He seemed to be not concerned about the imminent danger. He arose, rebuked the wind, rebuked the sea, and rebuked the men to be calm and steadfast and peace. And an even greater fear fell upon all the men on board, who murmured among themselves, "What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Pick up again in Mark chapter 5, verse 1. "And they came across over unto the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarenes of Arazanath. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs, the internment camps, the reservations, a man with an unclean spirit." "Who had his dwellings among the reservations, the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains, because that he had often been bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the internment camps and the reservations, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Yahushua from afar off, he ran and he worshipped him." "And he cried with a loud voice and said, 'What have I to do with you, Yahushua, you son of the Most High? I adjure you by Allah that you do not torment me.' Because Yahushua had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man. And Yahushua asked him, 'What is your name?' And he answered, saying, 'My name is God, for we are many.'" "And he besought him much that he would not send him away out of that country." No, out of the man. Casting him out of the man, right? No, out of that country is out of the man, because the man and the land is tied together as one. Now, there was over there on the other side, near unto mountains, a great congregation of Khazars feeding. And all the devils besought Yahushua, saying, "Send us into the Khazars, that we may enter into them." And forthwith Yahushua gave them leave, and the unclean spirits went out and entered into the Khazars. And the whole congregation ran violently down the steep place into the sea. There were about 2,000 remaining from Arazanath, and were choked in the sea. Shalom Mashpaka, Shalom Akyam, Ua Akwatyam. I pray you have been edified and fulfilled with strong meat. Please do like, share, and comment on the content, and come again for more bombshell information revelations. Toda Rabbah.
all Abari should have been pronounced Abari. Abari.